Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining and welcome back to Wall Street Silver. Joining us today is our good friend, Bix Weir from the massive YouTube channel, Rote to Ruta. Bix, it's great to see you again.
It's nice to be here. I'm glad you guys are doing so well this year, getting those numbers up there, near 40,000. Very nice.
Thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
Yeah. We're coming up on our 1 year anniversary, March 1st for having, you know, we're just two amateur hacks on YouTube. That's me and Ivan.
No, you are.
But you're the pro. You've been doing this 5 years. So you've graduated, or 6 years. So you've graduated to pro status. And that's why we wanted to talk to you.
I actually, I've been writing about silver since the 90s.
Yeah.
And YouTube, it's kind of, I had a blog, which was doing really well. But once I got on YouTube, everything just exploded. And so many people are using that avenue now.
YouTube channel, he's got 96,000 subscribers. Rote to Ruta is how you found it. And he, if you want to hear some, everything about silver and a few other things,
some conspiracies.
This is a channel that I would encourage everyone to check out and go subscribe to. What we wanted to talk to you about today is something that's, you're hot and heavy about, is the true silver to gold ratio. Tell us, what do you mean when you say that, the true silver to gold ratio?
Well, the silver-gold ratio was always set by humans and based off of not market trading, but it was actually set by people depending on how much they could get out of the ground. It's ranged from anywhere from 10 to 20 to 1. And then with the advent of computers and derivatives, we went off the silver standard, off the gold standard, all of a sudden it changed from, 10 to 20 to 1 to... we were up at what, 100 and something to one just recently?
Yeah, just last year during the virus, or not 2020, right? Wasn't it the virus hiccup back in March of 2020? Silver tanked, but gold didn't tank as much. So the ratio got up to 126 or something?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and it's pure manipulation. At the time, it was JP Morgan. We all knew that because they were the monster in the room, as they always are in silver, whether... they're holding everybody's physical silver in ETFs, or holding all the derivative short contracts, which they got in trouble for, or giving leased silver to Bank of America, you name it, anything to keep the price down. But the only thing that screams, like right now it's 79 to one. The only thing that screams 79 to one is the price. And that price is a fake price coming out of the ground. I think it's 7 to 1 right now. Yeah. Historically, I mean, nothing makes sense since the early 1970s when computers and derivatives were the driving factor in pricing of gold and silver. It's all fraud now. And you could tell by that, by the volumes on the COMEX. I mean, billions of ounces. I think the COMEX has 90 to 100 billion ounces of silver trading every year, when in history, it's only 60, 65 billion have been mined in history. But every year there's these crazy things called futures and options that are setting the price of silver, and that's why the gold silver ratio is so out of whack. I don't think the bankers really care about the price of gold. I think it's all about the price of silver. Keeping that price of silver suppressed is the number one thing for the bankers to keep this fraudulent monetary system going.
We just had an interview about I'd say 2 weeks ago with Keith Neumeyer. And that issue came up that it's only coming out of the ground at a ratio of 7 to 1. Mm-hmm. And he remembers, you go back two decades, the, early 2000s, where it was 11 or 12 to one was the ratio coming out of the ground. It's it's getting worse and worse as the easy silver gets mined out. We don't really have a gold supply cliff, because gold is not really consumed by industry, but there is a real silver supply cliff coming in terms of, we're getting off topic, but.
No, that's a good point. But that's just coming out of the ground. What it should be is what's already above ground. That's what should set the ratio. And then you can even argue that it should be whatever's being used as a monetary metal versus industrial. But above ground silver, there's about 6 billion ounces of above ground silver and about 6 billion ounces of above ground gold, which screams 1 to 1.
Yeah.
So the only thing that's out of whack is the price of silver. Everything else is screaming that this is going to correct. And I think it's going to correct very soon.
Well, something that's interesting. There's only about six, 6 billion ounces of silver above ground. If you ask someone like CPM Group or Metals Focus, they're going to tell you that number is 50 or 60 billion ounces or above. You know, they count all the mined silver throughout all history. It's above ground. But what they don't mention is 40 or 50 billion of it is in landfills and no one tracked where they put it. And yeah, so what's the usable? I mean, you got to ask yourself, okay, if I've got a 100 ounce, I got a little 1 ounce coin. Hey, self-promotion. It's one of our 1 ounce coins, Wall Street Silver. If I've got this, what do you got?
Oh, nice.
This
one?
It's a Roderuda coin.
Oh, it's
All
a Roderuda.
Right. Hey, self-promotion. Awesome. All right, I'm going to charge you for that. You promoted it.
But they can't buy it. No one can buy it. I only get the
same. Oh, nice.
No. So a piece of metal that's above ground and in my hand is worth one thing. If it's attached to some circuit board and it's buried in a landfill, what is that worth? Well, Keith Neumeyer would tell you that's worth basically nothing because it costs more to get it. They are so good at embedding this industrial silver into the paste and into the circuit boards. It's like they throw fire at it. They throw chemicals at it. They cannot profitably figure out how to remove silver from some of these products. So they just end up throwing the hardware into landfills because there's no way to recycle it. Now, is that silver worth the spot price, 23, 24? No, it's got a negative, it's got a value of zero because they can't figure out how to recycle it.
Well, that's, yes, great point. And, you know, you would go in and recycle it if silver was, you know, $10,000 an ounce. And that would make sense. It might make sense to go in and try to get that stuff out. But even with that argument, with the Jeffrey Christian argument, that's a 10 to 1 ratio. Mm-hmm. And right now we're sitting at 79 to 1. but that ratio is completely ridiculous because, no, it's not going to be, we're not going to dig up every landfill to find the 0.1 ounce of silver in a circuit board, things like that.
Literally, Keith Neumeyer told us he's invested in 3 recycling companies and 2 of them have gone bankrupt and the third one's probably going to go bankrupt, according to what he says. They've tried really hard to figure out recycling. And he says right now he thinks it would cost it to be just making money. You'd need about $70 an ounce for silver to make sense to recycle. And so he has a real problem with all the data that the Silver Institute's publishing in terms of their recycling. He thinks it's just a total fake. You know, they're claiming 170 million ounces a year are being recycled. Prove it. Where's this number coming from?
Mm-hmm.
Are really that many people are handed in scrap silver, you know, finished silver is being handed in at that level or silverware or whatever. A lot of people are questioning that raw data that Metals Focus is producing for the Silver Institute. And that's why Keith First Majestic no longer sponsors the Silver Institute because he doesn't agree with their data. Did you hear about that?
I did hear. And I mean, out of all the CEOs, obviously Keith is the one who's not afraid to stick his head out and say, hey, you other CEOs of silver mining companies need to wake up. I was screaming about that years ago. This is your commodity that you have to defend. It shouldn't be us, you know, keyboard jockeys out here analyzing silver to defend your product. I mean, this is your employees' lives. This is your community's lives. You know, these silver mines that have to shutter because the price is so low. Mexico is the biggest example of a country that hates its people. Mexico has exported about 30% of all silver that's ever been mined. Had Mexico not done that because of the price suppression, said, no, we're not going to export silver anymore because this is our valuable commodity. We're going to hang on to it. They would be the richest country in the world and their people wouldn't be living in squalor. Not all of them, but some of them are not doing well. No. And they still export the most silver in the world. It's just insane. Silver and gold should be and will be one day priced one-to-one when the scam of the COMEX and the silver rigging ends.
You know something? Far be it from me to go defending a socialist government, the current president of Mexico. But I was talking with James Anderson at Guanajuato Silver, and I was made aware that the current government is really stepping on the mining companies right now in terms of their tailings facilities. It is almost impossible today to get a new tailings area approved. And it, as a result, you know, the example of Guanajuato Silver, James Anderson told me, one of their neighboring mines has had to shut down because they reached their maximum capacity for their tailings. And that has been, that benefited Guanajuato because he's still got 4 years permitted on his mine. But it raises the point, is the government of Mexico starting to take those types of actions to limit the amount of silver that's being mined? Exactly like you said, it's like they can't halt it all because a lot of this stuff was already approved and the current mines are going. And
yeah,
but they're trying to dial back the amount of silver being mined in Mexico through regulation, not through, you know, just by making it difficult to get stuff approved.
Yeah. I think that's true on a bigger picture, because you see it all over South America. On a big picture, it's great for people who have silver in their hand. It's not great for the mine, obviously. But it's great for people. And that's where I always thought mining companies, I was a big investor in mining companies. Yeah. I think now they're too valuable to own. If we have a banking collapse, the first thing the government's going to do is going to nationalize all the silver they can get their hands on. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, that's an extreme version. And if you're a mining share owner, you need to have physical as a hedge against nationalization. Because if that world happens,
you don't think it'd be gold first before silver, the nationalization?
Well, not in Mexico and in South America, where, you know, silver is
the main.
Remember, we're going to see a shift to fair market value. So yeah, gold's important, but silver's so much more important than gold in almost every single respect. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you think about it, yeah, gold is priced at $1,840 and silver's priced at $2,350. But the reality is, they have equal value. Mm-hmm. And when that is shown in an exchange, all of a sudden the silver mines are going to be probably much more valuable than the gold mines, because industry needs that silver as well. So industry will be fighting for it. The investors will be fighting for it. The bankers will probably start stockpiling or trying to stockpile silver as well. I mean, we can see that the bankers stockpiling gold on the COMEX with the amount of deliveries they're taking. When are they going to start stockpiling silver, saying, oh my God, yeah, gold's great, but silver is so much better and more important in so many different aspects than gold is. So I think silver is going to be number one precious metal.
I think, you know, we'll see. There's certainly that argument to be made. I know Chile, the country of Chile, just had an election a few months ago, and the new president is far more left-wing, and they're doing a new constitution. But Chile is most known for copper. And as a byproduct, some gold and silver from the huge copper mines there. But almost a quarter of the planet's copper is coming out of Chile. And they're talking about that same thing with copper in Chile that you're referring to with silver in Mexico. And, you know, I think we are seeing that trend towards resource nationalism, countries defending their wealth. It's like there's not... Some of these guys, and it's smart strategically from their point of view, is why are we in a huge rush to mine everything out of our country as fast as possible? Let's dial it back, drive up the price, and extend the reserves out for an extra 50 to 100 years. What's the big rush to give away all of our wealth in 5 years, 10 years by mining it as fast as possible? Right?
You just explained the U.S. natural resource stance since the 1920s. We basically have the most stringent mining regulations, and a lot of mines are just shuttered in the United States. And oil, I mean, there's so much oil in Alaska that we've cut off in the Anwar National Park. And I mean, California and gold, oh my God, 41% of the land in California has been deemed to be the national government's, either in parks or the big one is the Desert Wildlife Preserve that Dianne Feinstein locked up after they found billions of ounces of gold at Chocolate Mountain. I mean, all this stuff is documented. It's just most people don't know it because the mainstream media listens to guys like Jeffrey Christian about things that are so important to countries. The biggest thing and reason for South America to curtail their mining operations is not necessarily the metals. It is the value of the currency. Mm-hmm. Unbacked fiat money is on its last legs. Even the US dollar is, mm-hmm. we're seeing it. They're printing it. I mean, they don't even tell us anymore how much they print. That's how big it is.
Yeah.
So yeah, I mean, obviously every country, if they want to save their population, the wealth of their country, will try any way they can to stop exporting the valuable in-ground commodities.
But, you know, one of the other things that you wanted to talk about is you feel, I'm going to bring up the silver chart here. What are you watching right now? This is the, just to tell the audience, this is the current silver chart on Friday. And the black line here is the 50-day moving average. The red line is the 100-day moving average. And this turquoise line up here is the 200-day moving average. What are you watching here?
So what the theory is, and this comes from Ted Butler, and he's absolutely right, that the big commercials play off the tech funds. The tech funds are big funds that basically are required by their investment strategy to buy or sell based on moving averages. The three big moving averages are 50-day, 100-day, and the real big one's the 200-day. So what Ted talks about is, hey, after these certain moving averages get breached, that's when the big bankers have to short into the rise, because all the tech funds have to take their shorts and turn them into longs. But they're very technical about it. It's already programmed into their computer. So when you breach something like the 100-day or 50-day moving average, a certain amount of tech funds are automatic buyers there. And if you go below it, they're automatic sellers. Mm-hmm. The big one's the 200-day moving average. And as you can see, the last two times that it came near the 200-day moving average, it was slammed down.
So you think next time, right now the 200-day moving average is around 2430. So you correct. Think that's the next point it would probably get really slammed down?
Slammed down, or as Ted has said many times, at some point, they can't keep playing this game. Now, Bank of America, we believe, has been the one shorting in place of JP Morgan, because JP Morgan is not allowed to do it anymore. The CFT or the DOJ came down on them and said, you can't rig the gold market anymore. You can still be the authorized custodian of all the silver of SLV, and all your customers. And if you see JP Morgan's customer account versus their house account hasn't done anything since the decision for the $920 million fine, but their customer account is everything, that and B of A. And, mm-hmm. and those are basically the two entities that are currently controlling the price of silver. And we think, Ted thinks, and through the data it shows, that B of A has a 800 plus million ounce leasing program with JP Morgan.
So here's one of the images you sent me. What's the point that you're trying to make with this image?
Okay, this is the OCC data, which is the Office of Comptroller and Currencies. This does not take into account any of the derivatives traded on the COMEX. Mm-hmm. This is OCC data off the books, off anybody can see. So this is where the leases would show up. And as you can see, and this is precious metals, the vast majority is silver. Gold has already been moved to another category. But the vast majority of this is silver. And as you can see, since 2019, since 2018, it was only $35 billion. And now it's way up there into the $70 billion range.
Wow.
And if you look at the other data, it shows who did it. Bank of America was not a player at all in silver until about 18 months ago. And look at them now, down there at the bottom far right, they have $18 billion with the precious metal derivatives. All of these are expiring this year. Now this, mm-hmm. this data, see, it says 1 month maturity back over to the left, 17 billion. B of A wasn't even on this chart 18 months ago. Mm-hmm. What was it that they did that could, if you take the price, this is third quarter 2001. If you take the price of silver back then, we hit the low. This is mm-hmm. a date in date stamp September 29th. We hit the low in silver, which was $21.50. Then that's what that value is. So you take 18 billion divided by the 21.50, and you get over 800 million ounces of silver that are derivatized. And we think it is a lease from JP Morgan because they're the only ones who had it. Ted Butler thinks they were bamboozled into leasing that much silver from JP Morgan. I think it was collusion with the CFTC. Rustin Benham, last year when you guys,
you said you got to tamp it down.
We have to tamp down silver, which is shocking. That's the head of the CFTC, the head regulator, saying we have to tamp down the price of silver because a bank or some banks were in trouble. And Goldman Sachs, Jeff Curry came out and said the same thing. And the lovely Jeffrey Christian, who works for, the big bankers, came out and said the same. They were panicking when silver was hitting $30. And then Private Advisors Group bought a third of SLV. I think that was one of the big players taking up the price of silver. And then all of a sudden, hey, we have to tamp it down. And Bank of America's silver leasing book goes through the roof.
What are you looking for 2022? Let's get your projections. You're a wildly optimistic bull, or are you a wildly pessimistic? They're gonna keep tamping it down and keep manipulating the market. Where do you stand?
I stand where I've always stood. I think silver should be freely traded. Mm-hmm. We should have a fair market value of silver. And if the CFTC can't facilitate that, which they have shown, they have a budget of $300 million and they just asked for another $100 million to regulate cryptocurrencies. Why do we have a regulator unless it's to run cover for the banking operation of rigging the price of silver and other commodities?
You're such a dreamer, Bix. You're such a dreamer.
But I'm telling you right now, it will never happen on the comics. The comics will have to shut down. Right now, 99% of the trades are just banks trading back and forth to each other to set the price. That's all it is. And they use a company called Virtu Financial, which is a high-frequency trading company, to do that. And they're an authorized participant of SLV, but they don't take delivery of any physical silver that I've ever seen. Why are they an authorized participant? And the guy who runs it is called Vinny Viola. I've pointed these guys out years
ago. That sounds like a mafia name.
He was Bernie Madoff's counterpart at the same time. He ran the NYMEX and Bernie Madoff ran the NASDAQ.
Yeah.
And then they split off to make Bernie Madoff Investments. And Vinny Viola split off to make EWT LLC, which turned into Virtu Financial, which had went years and years and years without a single day of losses ever.
Yeah,
it's insane what these people get away with. I just want free market value of silver, whatever that price is.
Give us a clickbait title. $1,000. What is it?
Oh, 1-to-1 price ratio with gold.
That's right on. That's beautiful clickbait right there.
Yeah, 1-to-1. Yeah, we'll see. Well, Bix, once again, thanks for joining us. The audience loves you. You're a hugely popular guy on your own channel. And we want to thank you for coming on our channel and sharing some of your wisdom. We really appreciate it.
Anytime. And as you guys know, the more information's out there of what's going on with the silver market, the more people, I can't even imagine how many people are now into silver learning, oh my God, it's rigged and the price is way too low. What a great thing to get an understanding of at the right time. Something as our financial system implodes, people are going to be screaming for hard assets and silver, I'd say, is the number one asset.
Well, that's what Wall Street Silver is. We just had our 1-year anniversary about 2 weeks ago, and we're at almost 181,000 members there talking about these exact same issues. We got our little Valentine's Day banner up right now, so please
I'm glad you cut it off halfway.
I'm in the toga there. Come on, it's all good clean. Once again, I want to encourage everyone to check out Road to Ruta channel and give Bix a subscribe if you want more silver content.
Absolutely, thank you so much.